Professor Goodmire will be on the stage when you arrive. You'll know it's him. He'll be carrying a copy of your collected poems.
The poet himself, though. It's
been some visit.
That reading last night.
Oh, boy.
I'll send you those poems of mine. There are about 20 of them I'd like to see.
Where am I going? Where?
Now, you look after yourself, will you, dear?
Give our regards to Goodmire.
Dear sir, I am submitting some further poems. I hope you will like them enough to consider publishing them, although I realize that their constant anatomical symbols are not to everyone's taste. Quite often, they are not even to my own. I'm coming up to London next week, and I hope to be living there for some time. I shall telephone you when I arrive. I agree that From Love's First Fever is a difficult poem. But whoever said poems ought to be easy?
Thomas. Mr. Thomas.
May I call you Dylan? We all think of you as Dylan, don't we?
My name is Goonmire, Henry Goonmire. This is my wife, Connie. She's a great admirer of yours.
Hi. You look tired.
Yeah, man.
And this is Professor Steve McLewis. Steve is planning a critical study of your poems. Oh, and that's Steve's wife, Imogen.
Hello, Dylan Thomas.
I'm planning a critical study of your poems, Dylan.
Well, now that the chief Indian is here, what do you say we get along to the powwow, huh? This way.
I need a drink.
Well, I guess we could all do with a drink, huh?
A beer would be fine. Lemonade or milk. Anything.
You hear that? Dylan says he wants a glass of milk.
He's pulling your leg.
Now, your reading is scheduled at 7:30 tonight in the Memorial Hall, and you'll be our guest at a small supper party at 6. So just about a dozen guests, including the dean.
What time is it now?
It's only 5:10. There's plenty of time. And I've arranged for you to meet representatives of the college paper. They go to press tonight.
Well, what are you going to do? What are you going to talk about?
The greatest living poet.
It must be something particular.
Yeah, whenever you read poetry, who do you read? I go to some of your favorite poets.
What are you going to read?
Where are you staying? I can't remember.
How are you enjoying yourself so far?
Oh, very much indeed.
Mr. Thomas, who's writing the best poetry?
Is it a competition?
Do people in England read poetry?
I don't know. Does poetry care if it's read by the British people might be a question. I do know that people prefer to read about poets rather than what the bleeders write.
Mr. Thomas, I believe you've published about 100 poems.
God, isn't it awful? Only 100. I'm here under false pretenses.
Himself before
Mr. Thomas, what are your impressions of the United States?
Our cities and the play. The earth. And the oblivion.
Will you be staying, Mom?
I think you've got plenty, thank you.
Poor Mr. Thomas.
Will you sleep with me?
Why should I want to do that?
Women do, sometimes.
Well, I find it isn't very enjoyable unless I know the person.
Some women are fascinated by poets.
Ah, well, we have them through here all the time. We had Auden last year and Robert Frost.
I'm different.
Yeah, I've noticed. You drink a lot more for a start. What you gonna read tonight? I hope you read Fern Hill.
Is he?
Steve says he'll be right along.
I know I should have insisted that he eat some dinner.
I told you, he was exhausted.
He has no right to be exhausted. This university is paying him $250. And if he goes out on that platform and falls flat on his face, I'll never be able to hold up my head. Oh, my God.
He isn't well.
Easy. What's the matter? Easy.
It's no good. I can't go on. I'm never going to see my wife and children again. They're dead. I know they're dead.
You'd have heard if there was something wrong.
I can't do it. I'm getting sick. What am I doing here?
I can't let him go.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Come on, Helen, let's go. Right, house somewhere. Come on.
Come on. And lose $250 smackers.
Well, maybe tomorrow, huh?
Tomorrow in Mountain City on a great plain or upstate or downwind. Where's the bloody slaves?
Guest tonight needs no introduction from me. His poetry is known throughout the English-speaking world, and he has been regarded as the most influential young poet writing in England today. He is a Welshman. Here he is, Mr. Dylan Thomas. Oh, my God.
I have this Kafka-like dream that I will be mouthing here, and
That's right. Laugh at an old ham. Sometimes I... do you mind? Sometimes I begin at the beginning, as God did. Other times, in the middle, or even at the end. If every hermaphrodite was a schizophrene, which half would you choose? Fern Hill is a farm called Fern Hill, where I used to spend my holidays with my aunt and my uncle. Now, as I was young and easy under the apple boughs, about the lilting house, and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes. And honored among wagons, I was prince of the apple towns. And once below a time, I lordly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And as I was green and carefree, famous among the barns about the happy yard, and singing as the farm was home in the sun that is young once only, time let me play and be golden in the mercy of his means. And green and golden I was huntsman and herdsman. The calves sang to my horn. The foxes on the hills barked clear and cold. And the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy streams. All the sun long it was running, it was lovely. The hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys. It was air and plain, lovely and watery, and fire green as grass. And nightly under the simple stars, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks, and the horses flashing into the dark. And then to awake, and the farm, like a wanderer white with the dew, come back, the cock on his shoulder. It was all shining. It was Adam and Maiden. The sky gathered again, and the sun grew round that very day. So it must have been after the birth of the simple light in the first spinning place, the spellbound horses walking warm out of the whinnying green stable onto the fields of praise. Nothing I cared in the lamb-white days that time would take me up to the swallow-thronged loft by the shadow of my hand in the moon that is always rising, nor that riding to sleep I should hear him fly with the high fields and wake to the farm forever fled from the childless land. Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea. What you can of a poem. The only thing that matters about poetry is the eternal movement behind it, the vast undercurrent of human grief, folly, pretension, exaltation, and ignorance. 24 years. 24 years remind the tears of my eyes. Bury the dead for fear that they walk to the grave in labor. In the groin of the natural doorway, I crouched like a tailor sewing a shroud for a journey. By the light of the meat-eating sun, dressed to die, the sensual strut begun. With my red veins full of money, in the final direction of the elementary town, I advance for as long as forever is.
Is inclined to worry unnecessarily, Doctor.
Now, he won't be able to use that wrist for a week or so, but it'll be a good excuse for him not to do his homework.
The effect is hardly likely to be noticed.
I'll leave with prescription. The nerves are a bit upset. He's a highly strung boy, isn't he?
Do you think there's anemia there, Doctor?
Oh, no. No, I wouldn't. Yeah. Get him to take that 4 times a day and keep the arm in a sling.
He'll be sorry not to write his poems.
Oh, there's a poet in the family, is there?
He's had one published in the Western Mail.
I expect the doctor has other calls to make, you know.
His requiem, they called it. Nobody cared a bit, folks said, when the wicked old man at the gate lay dead.
Gets it from you, does he, Mr. Thomas?
We are all poets, to begin with.
He really ought to be in bed.
He's fine now. He doesn't like being on his own, do you, Dylan? Come on. They're a great bunch. You're gonna love them.
Hello.
Yes. The dean wanted me to tell you that he thought the reading was a fantastic success. Everyone just dying to meet you, Dylan. Really looking forward to it. Hey, everybody! Everybody! Here he is!
Bread and milk with sugar. Eat it while it's hot, no?
Would you advise a girl to make a living if she wants to write serious poetry?
Go on the streets.
Ask him why he came to America.
Why did you come to America?
I needed the money.
Oh, no. He's got a better answer than that. He came to America, he says, as part of his lifelong search for naked ladies in Macintoshes. Didn't you, Dylan?
Where's Connie? I like Connie.
She's over there pouring drinks. Steve and Imogen want to have a word with you.
She said she'd drive me to the station?
Yeah, well, we're all going to drive you to the station.
I have things to ask you, Dylan Thomas? Is there some contemporary...
I first saw the light of day in a Glamorganshire villa. I grew up, and am I going to ask you? Grew up in the gossip of a small town and the distant thunder of English literature.
We are discussing Richard Lovelace. Last Friday, I asked you to find out something about him. I await the results of your labor with trepidation. Bynum?
Sir?
Speak to us, Bynum.
It's a poet, sir.
Brilliant. Anyone else?
1618 to 1658, sir.
Yes. Thomas K.L.
Yes, sir.
You will, of course, like all the others, have learnt the poem To Lucasta, on Going to the Wars. May we hear it, please?
Tell me not, sweet. I am unkind that from the nunnery of thy chaste breast and quiet mind to worn arms I fly.
Who was the boy who uttered that noise? Was it you, Bazard?
No, sir.
Griffiths?
No, sir.
Of thy chaste breast. It is not, as someone appears to think, an obscenity. Try to see what the poet meant. True, a new mistress now I chase, the first foe in the field, and with a stronger faith embrace a sword, a horse, a shield. What's this?
Articles for the school magazine, sir.
You know all about Lovelace, I suppose.
When he wrote the poem to Lucasta, he was 32 years of age, sir.
31. Yet, this inconstancy is such as you too shall adore. I could not love thee, dear, so much, loved I not honor more.
Right, Tom? I'm going to do it. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask
my lost love.
Hey, Dylan. Is it true you once went to Buckingham Palace to meet the Queen of England and spilt cigarette ash down the front of her dress?
My royal ashtray.
Where was your first poem published?
In a newspaper when I was 12. I cribbed it in the boy's own paper. It wasn't mine.
You're kidding.
Me tell lies about my childhood. My childhood has become like the childhood of somebody else.
Look, we've got to go now, huh?
An engulfing of young pillows by tears in the eyes. Salt raw bay. The sliced oxide.
My book will do full justice to your early years. Tell me, where is Fern Hill exactly?
There's no such place, vertical license.
No such place?
It doesn't exist.
Hey. Oh. Can I, thank you.
You told me there was.
Hey, we have to be at the railroad station in 20 minutes.
There is was.
Idris! 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 Idris? Idris?
I'm right by you.
You were hiding.
No. I've been up for rabbits with little Willie. He's had a lovely time. Say hello to little Willie.
He's got blood on him still.
He went for one old rabbit that was pregnant. Straight for the belly. Yes, yes. You go in there now. Want to see?
No.
You do, really? I can tell. We'll have baby rabbit pie for dinner, eh?
I won't eat it.
I'm in charge. Dad's gone to Swansea to borrow money from Uncle Bob. Mum's taking the butter to Carmarthen. There's nobody here but us. And Ivan's the hangman.
He never hanged anybody.
Oh, yes, he did. He lived in this house. And he hanged himself. In by there. I can feel his presence.
Over Sir John's hill, the hawk on fire hangs still. In a hoisted cloud, at drop of dusk, he pulls to his claws and gallows up the rays of his eyes, the small birds of the bay, and the shrill child's play, wars of the sparrows and such, who swansing dusk in wrangling hedges. And blithely they squawk to fiery Tyburn over the wrestle of elms, until the flesh, the noosed hawk crashes, and slowly the fishing, holy stalking heron in the river Tawi below bows his tilted headstone.
Ivan's the hangman never walked on the road. He went to Carmarthen across the fields. He locked his daughter up in the coal house when he found she had a lover. But she escaped and ran all the way to Carmarthen in a nightgown. Dew, is that sight?
Don't address, you might slip.
Who's this Idris? Huh? I am Ricketts Evans, employed at Carmarthen Jail. When I kick the chair away and jump, I shall hang like a piece of bacon!
No!
Is this America?
You're having a dream, sir.
It will go away in a minute.
I told you not to bother our guest. Get.
You feel better this morning? Sarah and I hope you'll spend the weekend with us. Remember? Edgar Humbone?
Uh,
These are my... my teeth, chest, stomach, tissues, and gout. The doctor in New York said they also cured. Soul burn. Heart doubt. Head spin. They don't, though. I'd like to be very quiet.
Bring some beer, some cold beer. And watch the seagulls. May I do that, dear kind Professor Humble?
In a newspaper. Poet. Tired of writing about the past, that melancholy place seeks a quiet corner without memories or responsibilities. Clean habits. Except occasionally. Fond of people. Especially. I'll watch. I'm just a voyeur.
Dylan, I've got a poem here that I'd like you to look at. In fact, I've got a couple of poems that I'd like
Hello,
to
Dylan.
Look.
Ed?
Oh, hi, Ben. You're just in time for cocktails.
Oh, no, thanks. It's a bit early for me. I just want to have a word with Dylan, if you don't mind.
Oh, okay. I think I'll try another one myself.
Well, everything's set for tonight.
Are we going somewhere?
You remember what we talked about last night?
I don't remember last night.
Well, you remember me. I'm Ben Bloomer. I'm writing a critical study of your life and works.
Oh, that Ben Bloomer. Yes, we're always meeting, aren't we? In Boston, Chicago, the Arizona Desert.
I've been sounding the dean out, and he likes the idea. It'll be a 2-year contract at first. Of course, they'd pay for passage for you and your family from England. We'd have to think up some sort of a title for you. How about Associate Professor of Creative Writing?
You mean I could stay here and work?
3 lectures a semester, no more. Well, the money's very good.
I agree. Where do I sign?
You'd be able to write as much as you like. The climate's good. It's a damn good university.
It's a beginning. It's a foundation. I know what you say you want to do. But try to be practical. A varsity man has got the world at his feet.
You see...
Oh, God. Oh, don't rest things on books, Laurie. How many times have I asked you?
It's all right. Just wipe off.
I had some odd notions when I was your age. Most of the people we regard as the giants of English literature had other jobs, you know. They were preachers, or they worked for the government, or they were gentlemen farmers. You see what I'm saying?
Oh, will you
That's right, next.
We all write the bloody stuff to start with. Nobody earns a living as a poet, Dullan. Not in the 20th century.
The dean has to meet you, of course. Jack Sprat would eat no fat, his wife would eat no dean.
She's a charming woman, the dean's wife.
Is she young?
No, charming. There's nothing to worry about. Just take it easy tonight.
Shit!
Dylan?
Those are my poems!
I'm writing.
No, you're not. You're looking in Daddy's desk.
No longer tremble. No longer tremble at a dead man's cut. Wise man's fart. A red lip tart. We have the fairy tales by. By heart. No longer tremble at a bishop's hut.
I won't see anything so as not to bother you. Daddy will be back soon. You won't leave the desk in a mess, will you?
Failed.
But the results aren't until tomorrow.
I was having a drink with the director of education. He's got them in his study.
I'm sorry, Dad.
You have failed in every single subject. Except English. You have failed Latin, French, history, physics, chemistry, geography, mathematics. It's a pity you didn't sit Spanish and music. You could have failed those two.
I didn't think I'd fail them all.
Never mind. You can try them all again next year.
There's no point.
What do you suggest? That!
There's a beer in the icebox.
I think a scotch would be better for me.
I think a scotch would be worse for you.
I need it for my nerves. For tonight, I'd like a golden scotch. And then a walk along the beach with you.
I have to fix the food.
Oh, just a teeny weeny walk. Walk is with Dylan. Just once. Nobody's looking.
You're crazy.
I love your hair, your skin, your breasts, your legs.
If you didn't talk so much, you'd feel better.
If I didn't talk, I'd be dead. In the beginning was the word. Do I love your hair, or the word of your hair? Your thighs, or the word of your thighs? Your flesh, or the word of your flesh? Words are a torture.
Why do you have to make such a fuss about everything?
I'm all there is.
Especially when the October wind with frosty fingers punishes my hair. Caught by the crabbing sun, I walk on fire and cast a shadow crab upon the land. By the sea's side, hearing the noise of birds.
Quack, quack.
Thomas, spelt backwards, is Samoth. Have you ever thought about that?
Watkins is, Snicktor.
What am I?
Nubile. Get me some beer mats.
Hey, he wants some beer mats.
Nine, I want. Now look.
Sarega, where's that?
Up the valley somewhere, isn't it?
That's good, that is.
There's root.
Why does penis rhyme with Venus?
Must be a reason.
Dylan! Sarah!
Ed, where's Dylan?
I think he's out there with Sarah.
Thank you.
worth it. Just to see his face.
Are you suggesting, Hambone, that your wife and I were behaving improperly just because I had sand on my elbow? You'll be saying next that I pinched your shirt, Bumbone. Oh no, Mr. Prof, don't send me. Oh. I was just practicing lines for a play.
Are you an actor?
That's a good question. Did I behave badly?
You would have if I let you.
You mean I didn't?
I think you ought to see a doctor. I am serious, Dylan.
They terrify me. They tell me to stop drinking. But it isn't drinking.
What is it, Dylan?
I don't write anymore. I can't, that's all. I've forgotten how to write bloody stuff.
Now. We can't have you monopolized by Sarah.
Dean's wife. I just want to say, what a beautiful part of America this is. And how my wife and children are looking forward enormously.
I'm Helen Bloomer. Ben Bloomer's wife.
Ben Bloomer's. Jesus, I need another drink.
I'll get you a lime juice.
Oh, a lime juice? Hell.
I've never liked doctors. I got it from my father.
He's still living.
My insides are private, he used to say. Yes, he's 76.
Was he a writer?
Not so you'd notice. I miss him every day.
I thought you said he was still living.
He's ill. He's one of nature's hypochondriacs.
Good. Dylan, the dean's coming down.
Tell him Dylan Thomas has just died. Of hospitality. Complicated by old poems on the brain.
Dylan.
Pull yourself together, Dylan. He'll want to hear your readings.
So glad you could come in.
Yeah.
We're hoping that he's going to do a reading for us a little later.
Hey, fine.
Good,
right?
Dr. Mr. Johnson here.
Good evening.
Is that good to you? You thought it was over. That's most of
You mustn't worry about Daddy. He isn't going to die yet.
The force that through the green fields drives the flower drives my green age, that blasts the roots of trees,
is my destroyer. And I am dumb to tell the crooked rose my youth is bent by the same wintry fever. The force that drives the water through the rocks drives my red blood, that dries the mouthing streams, turns mine to wax. And I am dumb to mouth unto my veins how at the mountain spring the same mouth sucks. The hand that whirls the water in the pool stirs the quicksand, that ropes the blowing wind, hauls my shroud sail. And I am dumb to tell the hanging man how of my clay is made the hangman. And I am dumb to tell the lover's tomb how at my sheet goes the same crooked worm.
Yes, I can't tell you how grateful I am to you for that fine rendering. That's one of my great favorites.
It was a pleasure.
If you were to join our staff, Mr. Thomas, how would you see your role as a teacher? I've been speaking to Ben Bloomer about some very interesting courses we could think about. What is the source of a poet's inspiration? That's never been satisfactorily explained.
No.
Hardly even been discussed from the inside. I suppose you've given it a great deal of thought. Am I making sense?
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Isness.
I'm sorry, I don't believe I've...
Isness, that's sense, backwards. Did you know T.S. Eliot, backwards, nearly spells toilets?
Oh, really?
Yes.
Now think. If you were to discuss the origin of particular poems with the students, the genesis, the seed, the way you experienced it, you could transform their whole creative outlook. You could take a poem like, for example, like The Force That Threw the Green Fuse and show where it came from.
No, I couldn't. It was a long time ago. He always thought he was dying, poor son.
Oh? Who was that?
He nearly did die once. I have dreams.
You dreamt your poems?
Christ, I wish I had.
Perhaps you could share your secrets with the students.
If I talk about the poems I wrote then, it reminds me of the poems I ought to be writing now.
You look younger than I expected. Have you come far today?
I have a flat in Chelsea.
You must be doing very well for yourself.
Actually, it's a room in Earl's Court. I share it with two Welshmen and a rat who likes boiled eggs. I have 8 pence in the world.
I decided many years ago it was a mistake to discuss money with an artist, and you are an artist. I read your first book when it was published. And it crossed my mind then we might be interested in your next venture, so I've read the poems you sent me with great interest.
Do you like them?
Yes and no. I like the ones I understand. Unfortunately, there are rather a lot I don't understand at all. They seem to me to smack of surrealism, which I abhor. Products of the subconscious mind. Better left where they came from.
You don't like them?
Let's not be hasty.
My poems do mean something. I'm sorry if they're difficult to understand, but why should the truth have to be expressed in words of one syllable? There are things in poems that are so complicated that even the poet can't understand them.
A It may be, but you can't expect your readers to pay 3 shillings and 6 pence for a book they're not going to understand.
You won't publish them.
If I don't, you'll only go somewhere else. We'll bring them out next year.
Could I have an advance?
What work are you doing in London?
I write poetry.
So do I, my dear Mr. Thomas. So do Mr. Elliot, and Mr. Spender, and Mr. Auden. But they all have jobs of some sort or another, or private means.
Could you lend me a pound?
I'm afraid I couldn't.
10 shillings?
You see, lending money complicates a relationship.
We haven't got a relationship. 5 shillings?
You really are creating a very awkward situation.
0.5 crown.
How did you get on with the dean?
I think he said the wrong thing.
Oh, what about his wife?
I haven't gotten to her yet.
She's important. She likes people to be serious.
I am. You couldn't write my kind of poem. You couldn't write good poems at all unless you were fundamentally a serious person.
What are we going to do about you?
Help me to escape.
Escape what?
I don't know, sing, deep, poems, me, especially me.
The heart is drained, that spelling in the scurry of chemic blood warned of the coming fury. By the sea's side, hear the dark voweled birds.
It's all lies. I never laid hands on anybody. I mean, you don't get much of a chance, do you?
Dylan has had a very exhausting trip.
We make demands on visiting writers. Look what we did to Charles Dickens.
Andrew Milkwood got a wonderful reception.
It's not properly finished. It will never be properly finished.
Dylan's a perfectionist.
Do tell us about it.
Wish I could work out what time it is in London.
You didn't bring your wife this time.
She said all I was coming for was flattery, idleness. I told her the real reason, the appreciation. I think that's the word I use. It's a lovely word. Poetry, another lovely word. And friends. I'm not sure about that one.
I'm working on a poem about Dylan in America.
There was a bleeding spider who went up the bleeding spout. Down came a thunderbolt and washed the bugger.
You must have met many hundreds of people on your tours.
Oh, the fibs they tell. They said that I met Shelley Winters in Hollywood, and I touched her on the bosom. If I'd dare.
You're destroying our illusions.
They said I was at Harvard, where I met somebody's wife, a lady of ample proportions. And I asked her if I could put my glass down for a minute. And I stood it right.
Oh.
I wouldn't go back to America for £1,000.
I heard something about you doing an opera with Stravinsky.
Incredible, isn't it? He wants me to go and stay with him in California. It'll appeal to you. A sort of latter-day Eden. The world is destroyed after nuclear war.
Well, you can't go wrong with the Garden of Eden.
Let's go to the shed. There's a bit of a poem to my father I'd like you to look at. Too proud to die, broken and blind, he died. The darkest way and did not turn away. A cold, kind man, brave in his burning pride, on that darkest day.
What do you think?
Well, I think you haven't finished it yet. I'm sorry I couldn't get to the funeral.
Yes, I know you would have, if you could have.
Why don't you go to California and write the opera? You could take Candle. Oh,
we can write the opera by correspondent.
I shall look forward to the first night.
I don't know if I want to write it, and if I can. I'm 38, I feel 83. I now look upon visits to London like descents into the city of the damned.
Well, that never stopped you going there.
No. America is 10 times worse. The pavements drill through your souls to your scalp, and out pops a lamppost covered with hair. In addition to which, I became entangled in New York with a sweet girl. I shall probably stay in this idyllic tomb for a long, long time. Maybe for ever. Catty!
I'm up here with your other favorite poet.
My American sponsor is coming over soon. He wants to know what the plans are. All he'll find is a pumpkin with a luminous toe.
This is a great spot. Could I have one of you both together?
This is Thomas' country, 6 feet down. You can hear them grumbling in Welsh when it rains.
Don't take any notice of him. There's my sister Anne. She and her husband had the farm at Fernhill. He's there, too.
Perhaps we could call it Fernhill, if it isn't too far.
It's changed.
Now, hold that. Great.
Oh, there's Bessie Williams. I must just go have a word with her. I'll be back now.
You've decided, then?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Catty thinks so, I think so. The bones of my ancestors think so.
Hello, Bessie.
I can't face America again. Cancel my engagements if there are any.
This photographer from America? Well,
how is Liz?
She's fine.
Oh, my God. Nice to see
me. I'm looking forward to the rest of the winter in Wales. Think of all the writing I'll be able to do. Dusk is drowned forever until tomorrow. It is all at once night now. The windy town is a hill of windows, and from the larruped waves, the lights of the lamps in the windows call back
like the day and the dead that have run away to sea. All over the calling dark, babies and old men are bribed and lullabied to sleep. I've added some here for you. You've got to sing it.
I'll try.
Very gently.
Rock-a-bye, Grandpa, in the treetop. When the wind blows, the cradle will rock. When the bough breaks, the cradle will fall. Down will come Grandpa, whiskers and all.
Let me get a copy of that to put into the phone book. You want to try it again?
You're going
to
try one more
time? I didn't think you were coming. I really didn't.
I wanted to do more milk oat.
Is that why you came?
1 minute I was entangled in lawn with sea mist, cockles, and the smell of decaying poems, and the next, dearest Liz, I was free. Perhaps I'm still there. Pinch me.
Where do you want to go?
Where do you want to go?
Well, what's wrong with the village?
Everything. Brooklyn, please.
Brooklyn?
Go on, get in. Go to that seafood place. You used to like that.
I like it here.
I like your life here.
I'm not going to drink this trip. I hardly drank at all this summer in London. They won't recognize us as the White Horse. Who's that incredibly sober man? God, he's sober. Look at the way his nose doesn't light up.
Where do you want?
Oh, sorry, just here. That's fine. Cranberry Street. Thanks. Keep the change. Just around the corner. Come on. Oh, Dylan, it's so lovely.
Here in the spring, stars float along in the void. There's a man back there.
So?
He was outside the poetry center.
Dylan, that's impossible.
He must have followed us by taxi.
I don't see anyone.
He was there. I didn't imagine it.
All right. All right. Come on, let's go have dinner.
What are we doing here, anyway?
Oh, Dylan, please.
Imagine the scene. The Welsh miner has been cutting coal all day. He is very black, he's very bored. He has had nothing to look at but blind horses and anthracite. And so his thoughts have naturally turned elsewhere. He goes home on the bus with 50 other black-faced men smelling of the dark. And when he gets to 44 Penro Khyber Terrace, what is the first thing he finds? His wife. smelling of baked stone bread and warm underclothes ready with the soap. The hip bath. The shadows on the ceiling. The slap of flesh against tin. The knock of ankle bones on the wet, flecked floor. Oh, the scrubbing and the rubbing and the circular push. They would never get them into the pithead bars.
Not unless he took their way.
Dylan, tell him about the time you put the brandy glass in the dean's wife's bosom. Excuse me, he said.
They know you, don't they?
Well, I certainly hope so. I heard you were in town, so I knew I'd find you here. Edgar and Sarah send their love. They might be moving to New York themselves.
I met you all in a dream.
You know, the book's coming along very nicely. The last chapter's going to be a bit difficult, though. Dylan, how do you see your future? I know you want to stay in the States. I know you want to stay in the States, but I saw some of those film scripts you wrote. They're really very good. Very good.
You thought about going out to the coast? Thought about the coast?
F. Scott Fitzgerald went out to Hollywood. Scott Fitzgerald was in Hollywood.
I think you did very well.
You did very well.
Oh, that's fantastic.
You do a lot worse than going out to California.
A lot worse than California.
It's a real writer's colony. Writer's colony.
By the sea's side, hear the dark-boweled birds.
He could do this sort of thing in his sleep.
Does sometimes.
All right, we'll start recording in the half minute.
I was at that moment chillily perched on a stool, old from sleep, at the tumbler-circled counter in the bellying buffet car, watching over my black lace-collared but liffy-less glass, the corpse grey liver sausage and the dredged tea, the putty rolls and the washing day lager being wolfed and lapped by furtive, small, damp physicists and large ball-playing booming boys with bulldog pipes and scarves as thick and many as a cabman's waistcoats. There, all about me, chastely dropping with gloved and mincing just-so fingers saccharine tablets into their cups of stewed Thames water, or poising their cigarette holders like blowpipes, or daintily raising the little finger crooked, a currant bun to the snapping flash of their long, strong teeth, tall and terrible women. Nade. Women, inaccessible as goat crags, nowhere on all this smacked and blossoming earth at home, except on lofty, cold bicycles with baskets at the front full of lettuce, library books, and starchless bread, aloofly scything along the high, the wind never raising their sensible skirts and their knitted pastel stockings full of old hockey muscles. And then, as I watched them all, desire raised its little fist. I did not want to be in England now that they were there. I did not want to be in England whether they were there or not. I wanted to be in Wales.
My aunt who lived here died when I was 18. I haven't been back since.
I can guess how you feel. And nothing I cared if my sky blue trades, that time allows in all its tuneful turning, so few and such morning songs. We should never go back to the places we loved as children.
Yes, well, to tell you the truth, I have been back here once or twice when no one's about. Looking for the emotion.
Looking at myself. Looking at myself.
You put the emotion in the poem.
I wanted to sing a unique song, unique for me, the poet, suffering uniquely. Do you think I'm a fraud?
Good God.
I've been accused.
Not by Ida Sitwell or Stephen Spender. Not by the people who listen to your reading.
Dylan! Aren't you going to show him the inside?
You'll find a stale fox and a stuffed fern and a ghost of me, aged 10, sitting on the stairs, looking into the future that's happened already and regretting a past that was long ago even then.
Deep breath. Again. Again. Well, I wouldn't exactly say your health has improved since you were here last. Those lungs are still wheezy.
I'm not sick every morning when I cough.
Now just look up. When did you start having the blackouts? You never mentioned them before.
About a year ago, when I started having headaches.
It's difficult to know with Dylan where to begin. You could shed 15 or 20 pounds with advantage.
I'm like a little walrus.
Stop drinking. I don't like the feel of your liver.
I knew it. Cirrhosis lies in wait. Baudelaire, Edgar Allan Poe, and now me. Accept my destiny.
You don't mean that.
When I was 18, I thought I had consumption. Well, it's what poets have. Cough.
You were very ill last night, Dylan.
Not very ill. I dreamt I was under the sea, blindfolded and handcuffed, bobbling and blowing bubbles.
This should ease your stomach.
What's that for? The rest of me?
It's cortisone. You have some edema. That's fluid in the wrong place in your tissues. It'll stop you aching.
The man with the winking needle.
Could you hold that, please? You will stay in bed all day. You will not touch alcohol. You will take the medicine that Liz gets for you. You will drink some milk. You will decide to start looking after yourself.
Can I smoke?
Not today. See, he behaves himself. I'd like to see you in my office in a few days' time.
I'm feeling better already.
I'm so glad you came.
Be tough with him, huh?
I will.
Mummy. Mummy. Bastard.
You heard what he said.
Be a good boy. Just one ciggy.
Oh, Dylan, please!
One ciggy?
No.
Thank you.
head.
Give me those cigarettes. Will you please get back into bed?
He's there again.
Outside the hotel.
There's no one there, Dylan.
Is that or is that not a man in a raincoat?
It's raining.
It's the same man. He's looking up at the window.
There he goes. He knows we've seen him.
Would you please get back into bed?
Hate me, don't you?
No. But it's not for your want of trying.
Come and sit with me. Give me some bread and milk.
I'll turn your pillows.
Evening star loves something. Middleton, 9 letters. Begins with H.
Harbinger. The evening star loves Harbinger.
God, it is too.
Paradise Lost, book 11, I believe.
That's the G for 12, of course. Geriatric. Must be. We're nearly there.
Well done. Next term, we shall be reading the Areopagitica. As good kill a man as kill a good book. Who kills a man kills a reasonable creature, God's image. But he who destroys a good book kills reason itself. Jenkins, did you hear what I said?
I think you should have a nap. We'll finish this later.
God knows why I bother. There isn't one of you could complete this quotation. Some natural tears they dropped, but wiped them soon. The world was all before them. Where to choose their place of rest, and Providence, their guide.
They hand in hand, with wandering steps and slow, through Eden, took their solitary way.
Well done.
You've done wonders with it.
I want to get it right. Sin.
I say I want to get it right, but I don't think I care if it's right or not. Been at it for years on and off. I should have been writing poems, not prose with blood pressure.
I'll get these new bits typed.
There's somebody at the door.
Probably just one of the maids.
God, I can't stand it.
Hi. I wasn't sure if this is the right room. Hi.
Hello, Ben. Dylan's very tired. He's been working all morning. I don't want him talking to anyone just now.
Oh, sure. It's okay. I'm by myself.
Please, Ben.
Well, I won't stay long. I just thought we ought to celebrate. I mean, I just heard about Dylan and Stravinsky. I mean, this is fabulous.
He doesn't want that.
I knew America was the place for you. So the teaching job didn't work out. It's okay, you don't need it. My publisher has a friend in the professional lecture business. You can make yourself some big money, Dylan. We could tie in my book with a lecture tour.
Haven't I seen you somewhere before?
Here's to the wonderful years ahead.
The thin, just thickens. A breeze from the creased water sighs the streets close under milk-waking wood. The wood whose every tree foot's cloven in the black, glad sight of the hunters of lovers. That is a God-built garden to Mary Ann sailors who know there is heaven on earth, and the chosen people of his kind fire in Paragib's land. That is the fair day farmhand's wantoning, ignorant chapel of bride beds. And to the Reverend Eli Jenkins, a green-leaved sermon on the innocence of men. The suddenly wind-shaken wood springs awake for the second dark time. That one spring day.
Dylan, you'll have to take another call.
Let me see my headache tonight. It is red with green stripes.
Dylan,
Oh, the pig lies down in his dung.
English, you see, they come from Wales. We're all bloody coal miners in Wales. I got scars.
But as I was telling you, the roof caved in, and we were trapped 3 miles down. There's nothing so worse. Is worse in the world as being trapped.
Dylan?
Where have you been? She's American. Welsh.
I came as soon as you rang. I didn't know where you were.
There was blood everywhere. Squelched underfoot like mud, only it was red. There were bodies squashed thin. Thin as thin bread and butter. Even the rats were screaming, and there was a man's brains all over his sandwich.
Dylan, for God's sake!
What do you know?
I'm sorry. None of this is true.
You think I haven't suffered? I've seen the gates of hell.
And I am dumb to tell the hanging man how of my clay is made the hangman's lime. I can't remember ever feeling as sick as this before. Day after day. I never did like my little body much. This is ridiculous.
What are you going to do about it?
Nothing, probably.
Dylan, let's go away. Take a vacation. Be happy.
God, look at that.
What?
Those two.
Why?
All that filth.
Dylan. The Welsh Puritan.
I am a Puritan. We all are over there.
You're making fun of me.
No, I'm not. There's something wrong with my head. You think I'm going mad?
I think if you're not very careful, you're going to have a breakdown.
Can't even have a beer without being sick.
Do you trust me?
I trust you.
Do you love me?
I love you.
I, Dylan.
I do.
Promise not to go.
Promise not to go.
To any more.
To any more.
Parties.
Thank you. Hello.
Oh, there you are, darling. Are you all right? Have they found some nice girl to look after you? Becky's here somewhere. We're all here somewhere.
I'm being followed.
By who?
Without a face. Is it death himself? I didn't tell you. Did I? You see the gates of hell.
The
brass knob. Asbestos.
How are you, my old friend?
Raving. I'm posing as a raving mad poet who has just seen the gates of hell. Oh, the frying flesh. And the popping eyeballs. Don't be frightened. They're only...
Our hostess has asked me to ask you if you would read one of your poems.
Please, Mr. Thomas. Come on, Dylan. Which one of your party pieces would we get tonight?
It's $10 a line.
I have your collected poems.
That slim.
For heaven's sakes, do something.
Come on, Dylan.
Go on, huh?
Dylan!
Mr. Thomas, please, do read.
Long words.
Come on, Dylan, read us a poem.
Nasty things. Words. They're not what they seem to be. They are the things themselves.
Could you read us that great poem to your deceased father, Do Not Go Gentle Into That Good Night?
Into that good night. Rage against the dying of the light.
Is he all right?
He better be.
Give me a hand, somebody.
Today's lecture on the arts in our contemporary society take the form of a reading by the famous, well-known Welsh poet and dramatist, Mr. Dylan Thomas. Mr. Thomas is in New York only briefly on his way to the West Coast to meet with Igor Stravinsky. And we are deeply honored by his presence, Mr. Thomas.
Fingers
punishes my hair. Caught by the crabbing sun, I walk on fire and cast a shadow crab upon the land. By the sea's side, hearing the noise of birds, hearing the raven cough in winter sticks, my busy heart, who shudders as she talks, sheds the syllabic blood and drains her words. Behind a pot of ferns, the wagging clock tells the hour's word. The neural meaning flies on the shafted disk, declaims the morning, and tells the windy weather in the cup. Especially when the October wind, the heart is drained, that spilling in the scurry of chemic blood, warned of the coming fury.
What time is it? What time is it?
It's about midnight. How do you feel?
Terrible. What day is it? Throat is like sandpaper.
I'll get you some orange juice.
It's very hot in here. Or is it me?
I think it's you.
No, I can't swallow it. I'm going for a walk.
No. That would be very silly.
Just a teeny little walk. I feel the walls are closing in.
If it's whiskey you want, there's whiskey here.
Liz, what's wrong with me?
I don't know.
Such a bloody awful mess. You and Katie and money and sex and new poems and gout and God knows what.
There's one thing about the horrors, Dylan. Just remember, they go away. They do go away.
I don't know where to look anymore.
To look for what?
My lost childhood. Poet weeps. You think I'm acting a part. Well, I am. You see, but the part is me. I weep for me. Weeping for me.
Self-pity.
All right, I'll die of self-pity. I didn't ask to be born, I didn't ask to be me. Why couldn't he give me a few quid to write the poems and leave me alone?
Dylan, you earn more than any of us.
I know. Embarrassing, isn't it?
You'd think there was something after you. Why were you running like that?
I don't know.
Oh, there's a fuss about nothing. Listen to me now. Your uncle has stopped in Carmarthen to see his pals. Shall you and me have tea by the fire?
Yeah.
Where's that boy, Idris?
He's in the kitchen.
No, he isn't.
You'll be frightening Dylan again.
Don't need to. He frightens himself.
You and me by the fire, is it? Just the two of us. Nice.
Straight whiskers. I think it's a record. I love you, but I'm alone.
It was nice of you to call.
Well, I was in Carmarthen, so I thought I'd come over.
Have you heard from Dylan lately?
Not very lately, no.
I got a card from London before he caught the aeroplane. Perhaps he's going to stay with Mr. Stravinsky by now. He misses not having Daddy to send his letters to. He used to send him such lovely letters. Well, he sent them to both of us, of course. But it was Daddy they were meant for. Will you have another cup?
No, I won't, thanks.
Will you go to the boathouse to see Catelyn?
Yes, just for a minute.
I do hope you'll be all right.
I expect there's a letter in the post.
I can't breathe. I can't breathe.
This will make things easier.
What is it?
Sweet dreams, a little morphine.
Will the triangles go away? I sleep so wrong.
Hold his hand. Very still now.
I can't breathe.
Some people live in Larne because they were born in Larne and saw no good reason to move. Others migrated here for a number of curious reasons from places as distant and improbable as Tonopandy or even England, and have now been absorbed by the natives. Some entered the town in the dark and immediately disappeared, and can sometimes be heard on hushed black nights making noises in ruined houses.
The
anagram of Eden is need.
Why are you crying?
The shapes go away.
Yes. In the end.
End is in Eden, too. I wish all the words.
You have been listening to Vintage Town, an impression of Larne in Carmarthenshire, with contributions from some of the interesting folk who live here. Dylan Thomas is abroad at present, and his talk was recorded.
Feltenstein there. Well, you must find him. I want him to see Mr. Dylan Thomas right away. But he can't breathe. He's turning blue. Please help me. I think he's dying.
I'm writing.
No, you're not. You're looking in Daddy's desk.
I write poetry.
So do Mr. Elliot and Mr. Spender.
There's no such place, Bertie Gleason.
No such place?
It doesn't exist.
I think I said the wrong thing.
Do not go gentle into that
good night. I was entangled with Lon. Perhaps I'm still there. How of my clay is made the hangman?